Hello, it's Mr. Muffin at Mr. Muffin's Trains. How are you today? Hey, we've had a lot of people ask us about planning their own layouts and building their own layouts, and there's lots of material you can read about that on the internet. There's lots of websites, all that kind of stuff. And you know, and some of it I think is really good, and some of it I think's and so what we thought we'd do, Mrs. Muffin and I, we thought we'd do a little recording for you of some of the concepts that we follow when we're building a layout, when we're designing a layout, to kind of help you out with that. So that's what we're gonna do. So this is session one of that topic. Okay, so let's talk about, you're thinking about building a model train layout. Now, there's the first thing you have to decide is the layout going to be like an island? It's gonna be in the middle of a room. You're gonna be able to walk all the way around it, which has some attraction to it. It's not a very efficient use of space, but if you have a lot of room, you don't really care. It's kind of like a pool table. You can walk all the way around it, and you can build the scenery up in such a way that the outside area of the layout is at the lowest elevation. And as you go farther in, you've got a city or a mountain or whatever that might be. And it requires you then to walk all the way around the layout to see the whole thing. We don't want to build a helicopter layout. We don't want to build a layout where you can stand in one place and see everything. It gets really boring. So we want to, even in an island layout, we want to build it in such a way we have to walk around to take a look at it. Okay, the second option on building a layout is not an island layout, but to do a round the wall layout. So in this case, what you're doing is you're building the layout tables up against the wall, and you're kind of filling up the room, and you're in the middle of the layout, kind of like I'm in the middle of our layout here. I have trains all around me, right? Now, one of the advantages I like of a round the wall layout is you end up with a lot more bench work. You can put in there a lot more trains in the same space. The other thing I like about it is the way you do the backdrops. Come over here and take a look at this. So because you're doing a round the wall layout, the wall becomes part of your scenery. And as you can see, Mrs. Muffin has painted it sky blue, and then she's added clouds. There's a whole story about that, using spray paint. And so it gives us this beautiful backdrop, okay? And so when you're doing a round the wall layout, then you have the opportunity to build the kind of backdrop like that. Okay, the second thing to think about, now that you've decided, are you gonna build an island layout or are you gonna build a round the wall layout, is how tall the bench work is going to be, right? There are some people that say you gotta do it at 30 inches, 32 inches, 36 inches. Oh my God, that's way too low. So if you look at our bench work, the main level of the layout is at 45 inches. And maybe that's a little too high. Maybe you wanna have it at 42. And the question would be, well, why do we want it up there? Well, we want it up there, A, because the closer the trains are to your eyes, the cooler they look. You wanna watch them go by, right? And you can see I'm sitting on my stool, my tall stool, and I'm looking at the layout over here, and the base is at 45 inches, and the trains are like right here. You know, they're not down low somewhere, okay? The other thing we like about a layout that's tall like that is we can buy stools like this stool right here. This is a stool. This came from Sears. It has four rollers. And amazingly, I can sit on this stool and roll under the layout. And why would I want to do that? Well, I want to do that to do the wiring, to be able to pull the wiring. I like the fact that I can be on a stool with rollers and I can roll under the layout, okay? So I think your bench work, the main level of the layout, ought to be at 42, 43, 44, 45, or even 46 inches off the floor. Another advantage of the layout being tall like that is you can install shelves underneath it like we have here. These shelves are made out of just 1x4s we buy at Lowe's. We cut them to length, and we groove ours on a table saw for the wheels. You don't have to do that, but that makes it really nice. And then behind it is just B-board that's screwed to the back. And you can put these shelves together very quickly, put them underneath the layout. There's still plenty of room to get underneath there with the rolling stool. But this gives you some nice train storage. Chapter 3. Okay, we've talked about, is it going to be an island layout or is it going to be a round the wall layout, right? We talked about that first. We kind of figured that out. And then we talked about how high the benchwork ought to be. And I'm telling you, it ought to be 42 to 46 inches at the main level, okay? Then how do you build the benchwork? Well, it's really very simple. You go to Lowe's or Home Depot, and you buy 1x4 pine boards. They're not quite 1 inches, they're not quite 4 inches, but they're really close. And you build them in a frame, okay? A little frame. You can make them 8 feet long if you want, or 4 feet long, or 6 feet long. And you've got cross pieces in there every 2 feet. So let's say I got an 8-foot board. I have a cross piece at the bottom. And then 2 feet up, I have a cross piece. 2 feet up, I have a cross piece. 2 feet up, I have a cross piece. And then I got the top is at the 8 foot, right? So it's going to take 5 1x4s every 2 feet to make basically like a ladder, okay? And that you we make that out of 1x4s. Now, once we've got that made, and I'll put some pictures in here for you of what that looks like. I've got some from the layout in Carmel. Once we've got the 1x4 frame made, we're going to stand that thing up on legs. And all you need for legs are 2x4s. You don't need 4x4s. You don't need to cut down a tree. You don't need anything like that. Just a 2x4 is all you need. And so you're going to put a 2x4 in each corner of the 1x4 frame we talked about. Probably for the middle one, the first one, I would put 2 more legs in the middle. So I'd have 6 2x4 legs holding, right, a 4-foot by 8-foot frame that we made out of 1x4s. And we're going to put clamps on there before we screw them, and we're going to use a level. We're going to get it nice and level. Once we get the first one built, we can then add more on. We can build another frame, screw it to the first frame, put on some more legs, do another frame, screw it to the first two, put on some more legs, and we kind of build out the benchwork. That's how we do it. I'll put some pictures in here. Show you what some of the 1x4 frames look like. This entire base layout is made out of those 1x4 boxes. The other thing we can do instead of building our own benchwork is to buy benchwork. We have some friends up in Maine, the state of Maine. The name of their company is Maine. I'll put a link up in the video for you and show you what it looks like. And they make a prefabricated benchwork kit. And you can buy it in whatever height you want. This is 42 inches. And it comes with sides and pieces. You can make the benchwork whatever size you want, and it's very cost effective. You know, which means it's a good bargain. And then you can buy the kit and just bolt it together. One of the advantages of their system is A, if you're not into woodworking, it's a good thing. And B, it's easy to take apart. So if you want to move your train layout, put it in another location, whatever that might be, you can unscrew all their benchwork, put it back in the box, take it to a new location, and put it back together. Anyway, I like their stuff a lot. Mrs. Muffin reminded me I've got a small section of the Bain benchwork set up here at the front of the layout for people to take a look at. And I really like the quality of what they have. One of the other things that's interesting about their product line, they make basically a section that's kind of like an elevated bridge. You can press a button and it lifts up so you can walk underneath it and go into the middle of the layout. And that's very popular. There are people that just buy that elevated section and add it to their layout to basically have the ability to walk in without doing a duck under. I wish I designed that into our layout, but I didn't. Maybe I should go back and do that over. Okay, let's talk about the top that goes on the benchwork. Whether you bought the main kit and you have that built ready to go, or you built it out of 1x4s sitting on 2x4 legs like we showed you, you're going to need to put a top on there. And the question is, what kind of a top? Well, plywood works fine. You can get plywood that's smooth on one side, right? What's that called? AB or BA or BC or DF or something like that. But it's pretty good stuff. You can get that kind of plywood. And the question is, how thick do you need it to be? Well, 1/2 inch is okay. 5/8 is better. 3/4 inch is probably too much. The other thing you can do is use MDF. Multi-density fiberboard, which is made out of glued together sawdust. One of the advantages of MDS is it's really smooth, so it's very flat. There's no rough edges to it at all, and it takes paint really well, so I kind of like MDF. 1/2 inch MDF's pretty cool. Now, it is heavy. It's hard to carry. Well, even plywood's hard to carry. So if moving around 4x8 sheets, what we did is we brought in some baseball players from Hamilton Heights. Let them carry that stuff around. It's too heavy for an old man like me. If you don't happen to have a bunch of baseball players available, when you go to Lowe's or Home Depot, have it cut into 4x4 sheets. Because even Mrs. Muffin and I can move a 4x4 sheet. So we're going to have basically the benchwork covered in MDF, if you like, or plywood cut into 4x4 sheets. And we're just going to lay it on top and we're going to screw it in. Let's talk a little bit more about the tops of the benchwork for a second. The question is, what do we do on top of that benchwork, right? And what we do is we paint everything the same color. We have a dirt color we really like. It's called Tender Twig. We get it from Lowe's. You might pick that. And everything gets painted the same color, which makes it very, very ubiquitous, right? And then once we've got it all painted Tender Twig, when we go to do scenery, we go to do grasses and hills and mountains and all that kind of stuff, it just goes right over the top of the Tender Twig. But we want to have everything a single base color, okay? Now, some people are gonna tell you you wanna put a sheet of foam on top of the plywood. Okay, here's why that's a bad idea. First of all, it doesn't take paint really well. Secondly, if you put a layer of foam on there, it's a lot harder to put your track down because the track doesn't gonna screw to the foam. You're gonna have to find a way to go all the way through the foam to get to the plywood. So I don't like any of that, right? We're going to build the layout right on top of the plywood or the MDF. We can add foam for scenery and for mountains. We can break it up, cut it up, carve it up, do all kinds of cool stuff. We do a lot with plaster cloth. We'll talk about that. So we're not going to worry about any of that. Now, in the old days, we used to buy some stuff called homasote. It's a fiberboard we put down to get rid of some of the noise. And it's expensive. And you don't need it. It ain't your grandpa's train layout, okay? You don't need homasote. So forget about homasote. There are other guys that swear by it. I'm not one of them. We lay all of our track on top of Woodland Scenic's foam roadbed. And we don't glue the roadbed down. We just push the roadbed under the track and put in the track screws. So if you're using Atlas or using Gargraves and Ross, we're gonna screw it down to the foam roadbed. If you're using Fast Track, which has got a built-in roadbed, or MTH Real Track, which has a built-in roadbed, you don't need to put the foam underneath it. It ain't gonna help, right? And we can make that look very realistic by ballasting it, right? I got a friend up in Minnesota. Got a beautiful fast track layout. He's ballasted the whole thing. So you can see Mrs. Muffin showing you right there some of our Atlas track with Woodland Scenics roadbed and then the way we ballast it. We're going to talk more about ballasting later. Okay, let's talk about designing the layout. We talked about how to build the benchwork, how to get that in, put in place. You've picked a room you're going to do this in. You've made a decision, are you going to do an island layout or are you going to do a round the wall layout, okay? So if we're going to do an island layout, you're going to want to have probably a 2-foot walkway all the way around the layout, maybe a little more than that. The layouts we build in our basement, you know, it didn't accommodate a lot of people down there at one time. It was really for me. So most of the aisleways were 2 feet or maybe 30 inches, right? At this layout, because we want to accommodate wheelchairs, we leave 40 inches between the bench work. That way we can get a wheelchair through. That's Mrs. Muffin's rule. Everything we build has got to have enough space for a wheelchair. Now, I'll tell you the truth. I built a part of the layout over there. I got it all done. I got a tender twig painted. I was working on the scenery. Mrs. Muffin came in with a chainsaw or whatever kind of saw it was and cut a big piece of it off the end because it wasn't 40 inches wide. She just went right through my scenery and just cut that off. So whatever size aisle you're going to go with, you're going to decide on that and stick with it. Okay, so now we are designing the layout. How are we going to put it together with the benchwork and get this thing the way we want it to go, right? And so we've decided on a big island, which is pretty easy to do, or we're going to do a round the wall layout in our room, okay? What I try to do is get all the benchwork in there I can possibly get in there because Mrs. Muffin could take some of it out if I have to. So I'm trying to figure out how to get large surfaces in there that I can work with. The number one thing we want to do with our planning is figure out where are we going to turn the trains around, because that's going to take the most space. So if you look right here, for example, we have a double track main line running through this little town right here. And then we have a third main line joining it, come in from that back bridge. And they come into this curved section, and now we're going to turn the track around and begin heading back that way, right? So this is an area where we're going to turn the track around. And the area where we're going to turn the track around is going to take up the most space. So we have to decide on this level of track. At a minimum, we're going to have to turn the trains around twice, once on each end, like a big dog leg or something like that, right? And those spaces are going to be the largest. And we can come out like we did here. We can come out, bring the main line out in order to give ourselves more room to turn it around, okay? Now on our layout, our minimum curve is an 072, which means it's 72 inches diameter from the center rail here to the center rail at the end of the curve. So it's going to take 6 feet to turn around that track, center rail to center rail, right? That's 072. 081 is going to take what? It's going to take 81 inches center rail to center rail to turn the track around. 054 is going to take 54 inches center rail to center rail to turn the track around. Now, if you're a little bit constrained, what you can do is use different size curves in the same turnaround. You can start with the bigger ones and then go to slightly smaller to give yourself some space and then take it back out to big, right? You can do something like that. So on your layout that you're planning, this main level of track, which is 45 inches off the ground, we're gonna do a lot of long runs and we got to find a way to turn the track around twice, right? Part of my design philosophy is to make the main level pretty simple. So we've got long runs and we're turning the train around. So maybe it's a big L shape you're doing. Maybe it's a big U you're doing. And we got to leave room on both ends of the U to turn the trains around, right? Now what you can do is you could close that U off, make it into a big oval. You can leave yourself a pathway to walk through, and you can just use a piece of 1x12 or 1x10 board to make a bridge that you just set in there in the opening. So when you need to walk through, you pick the track up, you walk through, and you set it back. Now that piece of track that you pick up is going to have wire connected to it to have power, but that's no big deal. You know, it doesn't need to be hinged. You don't need a working bridge. You know, you can buy one of those if you want. Okay, great. You don't need it. A piece of 1x12 is all you need to create a bridge that you could walk through. We could do that right here. This track right here could have come straight across here past me, come over here and connected with this track. And I just would have had a nice bridge in here we made to fill in that space when I didn't need to walk through it. Okay, like look back here. This bridge is made out of a piece of 1x10, doesn't it? And these bridge sides, they come from my friends at TW Train Work. They laser cut those. They look great. They've got these bridge abutments here. They look great. All right. So we're designing the first level of the track. We got to figure out where do we turn the track around. That's the most important part. That's going to be the widest because that's where the curves are going to be. And so whether I'm doing a U or an L or maybe part of a U, you know, maybe I'm doing a long one over there and then I'm coming back. So where are we going to put the curves? Where are we going to turn the track around is the most important aspect. Okay, now, that whole level, the main level of your layout that we've talked about, 42, 43, 44, 45 inches off the ground, does not have to be all one level. Like, look what we did here at the layout. This is our main level. What we did is we took a saw, we cut out part of the benchwork and dropped it. And that gave us this town scene. That we could put buildings in here. There's not supposed to be a train sitting on the street. I apologize. I'll move that train off of there. I don't know why I did that. But I've got this lowered scene right here with buildings and stuff in it. That third track is in the back is on a bridge. I've got a bridge right here. This is very nice photography right here. So it doesn't have to be all one level. So when you're building the benchwork, look at where can you lower it. Maybe you want to lower it a lot and have a river scene down there. Maybe you want to have another city scene down there. So you got a chance to lower it on that main level. Cool. Here's the same idea. Okay, this is the main level of the layout. This bridge needs to get a little glue on there. I didn't notice that till just now. I apologize. Always something under construction around here. So again, this is the main level. We've put in a 1x10 or 1x12 or something like that here to use as the bridge. And then we dropped the benchwork down. This is about, I don't know, 36 inches off the ground. And we built a city scene down here that the trains run past on these elevated bridges. So this is just a lower section of benchwork again. And then we added a train down here. And this is kind of fun because this train is on a really small loop, and it basically pops out, runs through the scene, and disappears. And then it pops out, runs through the scene, and disappears. We've done the same thing on the other side of the benchwork. That's this train, this nickel plate GP, is that a 35? I can't remember. Is anybody out there? Is that a GP35? I think it is. None of my nickel plate people are here right now, but it looks like a GP35. So this GP35 runs through this part of the scene, disappears into a tunnel, pops out on the other side into another city scene, and comes back around. So even though the main level of your bench work is at 45 inches, you can drop down and lay in a city scene or lay in a water scene or, you know, a zoo or anything that you know, captures your imagination, right? Below the main level of the layout. Okay, so let's talk about, we've got the main level of the layout designed. We got all the bench work in where we want it to go. We figured out where we're going to lay our track. We paid a lot of attention to where do we turn the trains around. That takes the most room, right? We got that main level in. Okay, now that we got that main level in, we got the trains on it, it's running. We want to start to break up the layout into sections, kind of like view blocking. And we do that when we add a second level. So here, for example, is a second level. Originally, that level was on benchwork. So there's raised benchwork back there that divides the view of the layout. You can't see what's on the other side of that bridge. You can't see what's on the other side of that benchwork. So we've raised up some benchwork. We put it kind of in the middle. And now we've got trains running up here. And what I like to do on the second level is use a little bit tighter curves and find opportunities for those trains to come out on a bridge and cross the first level, which I think is very important. It creates a great view. So these trains on this second level on these bridges, and again, this could be, you know, plywood you cut, or they could be bridges like we have. There's lots of different ways to do it. We're going to cross over this main level and then come out here over another level. Notice it's slightly lower than the 45 inches. We brought this down a little bit and we create this city scene here with this second level of track running through. Notice the main level of track, you can't see it here anywhere. We ended the main level back a few feet by putting those big curves in, and we hid them from the visitor, right? They're inside that tunnel. And then out here, we have this bridge level that comes out like this, comes around the corner, heads that way, and underneath that is the main line at the 45 inches, right? So the main line's at the 45 inches. The second level's here. Obviously, I've got a third level up here and a fourth level and so forth. But these levels let you break up the scenery into views, okay? So we come this way. Here, we're on the second level here. Then we keep coming this way. The main line is going through there. And the second level, again, crosses the main line. You can see the main line pop out over here. The main line pops out, the second level's above, and away we go. Now you'll notice on the layout, the design, we don't generally run the track right up to the edge, because we really want to do a lot of scenery things for people to look at between the edge of the layout and the trains, right? So like in this case, the trains come through behind, then they come out here. Again, there's the second level. Here's the main tracks coming through here, heading back underneath. That second level's going across bridges. Here's where that nickel plate GP35 will be coming around again. So we have that little simple loop. GP35 will be running through there. A Again, this is the main level, but we have bridges above that, right? Okay, so what we're trying to do from a design point of view is use the different elevations of track and bench work to divide the layout up into scenes. So even if you have a relatively small layout, you can still use scenery and a second level of track and bridges to divide it up. So we can't see the whole thing in one place, okay? Does that make sense? Okay. Okay, let's talk about reaching. We haven't talked about reaching yet. Your ability to reach into the layout is about 2.5 feet, roughly, right? And we got stuff in there that's farther away than 2.5 feet. So like we talked about the island layout, if the island layout is 5 feet across or maybe 6 feet across, you can reach it from both sides. That's very helpful. We have another tool that you can use, particularly when you're building around the wall layout, called a topside creeper. This is a topside creeper. I bought mine from MicroMart online. Paid less than $300 for it. What this is used for is to do engine work on a diesel truck. It gets you up really high. And so the topside creeper, if I can uncreep it, I got it locked in position here in case kids come by. Oh yeah, I got a train car up there too. But you can see with the topside creeper, I can roll this up to the layout, climb up the ladder, and reach way in here to work on the scenery, right? If you've got a grandkid, they can actually sit on this cushion right here and help you with scenery. So the topside creeper is how we're going to basically build and maintain the layout when it's farther than, let's say, 2 feet or 2.5 feet from your reach. That's a topside creeper right there. This is an example of a shelf layout. We've added it to our big layout. There's going to be a second level here eventually. But what we did basically at the very end of the layout, we have a big section to turn the trains around like we've talked about, right? And this is designed so I can run big steam engines here and turn them around. Once I've got them turned around and I look at this part of the layout, this is only 31 inches wide from the wall. It's pretty easy to reach everything. I don't really need the topside creeper. And so this shelf layout, 31 inches, has got two double track main lines. And then I've got a large passenger yard we built here in the middle. It's kind of hard to see it with all these trains. And then we go all the way down and we go through that wall down there. So you can see here, to do this, we went through this display wall we'd built. And we created an opening. We can get four tracks through there. It's a double track main line. So the four tracks go right through the wall and come out on the other side. So you might want to go through a wall in your basement or wherever you're planning to build this. And again, over here, the layout's only 30 some inches deep. You can see that until you get to the end, which is where we need to do what? Where we need to turn the trains around. And that's the purpose of this city area up here, is to turn the trains around. So from a design point of view, we need one place to turn the trains around and we need another place to turn the trains around. And in this layout, it's just 100 feet long, a straight track. You certainly could do something more interesting than we did here. But you get the idea. Hello again, I'm back here at the Transformer, sitting on my favorite stool. So let's just review briefly what we've talked about. Okay, we're gonna build a model train layout. We're gonna create a family hobby. We're gonna do it together. We picked a room in the house or above the garage, or we rented a space somewhere, whatever we decided to do. The first thing we gotta do is to figure out if I'm gonna do a round the wall layout or am I gonna do an island, right? Second thing I gotta do is figure out how tall it's gonna be. And I suggest 42 to 45 inches. Why? Because I want the trains to be up close to my face, A, and B, I wanna be able to roll around underneath it to do wiring. Makes my life a lot easier. Now we're talking about designing the layout, designing the benchwork. How are we gonna fill the room with benchwork? We need to leave some aisleways, but the most important design idea is, how do I turn the trains around? Where do I put the curves to turn the trains around? That's gonna take the most space. So when you look at the space you have and figure out, where can I turn the trains around? 180 degrees. I gotta turn them around and get them going back the direction they came, right? And so on every layout, I'm gonna have to have at least two places where I'm gonna turn the trains all the way around. That might be a U shape, it might be an L shape, elongated U, maybe it's an M, maybe it's the letter N, heck, I don't know.
Dog bone,
but we gotta have a place to turn the trains around, right? And as I showed you on our layout, it's kinda cool if you turn the trains around before the benchwork, before the layout ends. So you've got an extra place for cool scenery without the mainline trains, right? And on our layout, there's lots of those, okay? We're thinking about building a second level once we get the first level in and working, and we're gonna use the second level to crisscross the first level because that's very interesting, and it helps us divide the layout up into scenes.